And welcome to another edition of the Big High School Sports Show. I am... No, it is not the Big High School. Good morning. The time is 8:07. Currently 31 degrees with some sunny skies outside our studios. I'm Chad Holmes. It is the Thursday edition of the Chad Holmes Show here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. BowFallsRadio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa. By searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app.
Sometimes, it's almost the end of the week. Okay.
Yeah, sometimes I don't know exactly where I am, what time it is, but we just keep moving forward, don't we? And we're ready for another terrific morning. Glad you could be with us. And a beautiful start as I look outside the window. Lots of blue skies. Again, mild temperatures. The snow is almost gone completely, and it's going to continue that way. We'll find out about our forecast as we get towards the weekend when we're joined by meteorologist Brittany Merlot coming up in about 13 minutes or so. Good morning to Ian Welsh. And again, I guess are we having trouble again connecting here?
We weren't having audio issues before we started. But then he called me on the phone and said he couldn't hear anything at all.
Well,
I hooked up on the phone, so we'll get it worked out.
To be honest with you, I miss the old days of just doing a radio show as opposed to a TV show, but that is just me as I really get off to a wonderfully good start this morning, I tell you. But we're going to bring in the man to save me right now because, doggone it, I'm sinking fast here. And we're joined by Pat Kreitlow, the host of Up North News Radio, each and every weekday morning from 6 until 8 a.m. right here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Pat, good morning.
Hey, hey. Good morning. As we continue our way through the technological forest and find a path to the promised land.
Exactly. And frankly, your voice to me sounds just as good this way. And I introduced the show by saying it's the Big High School Sports Show because I have no idea where I am this morning. And it's just, it is just one of those things where my mind, I don't know, I'm bouncing off these four walls and I need a little more cushioning right now. But glad you could join us to try to get us back on the right track here.
Oh, yeah.
A lot going on. And this morning I was hearing some of the news and I was, you know, getting ready. And again, in Madison, there's a push for more legislation concerning diversity and equity. And beyond the bills that are being pushed right now, the general sense of where you think this discussion is, where do you think the people are in this state? Because we get a lot about where the Republicans are in terms of elected officials, where the Democrats are in terms of elected officials. In talking to people, where do you think the people of Wisconsin are when it comes to this this issue and this whole discussion? Do they feel like this is the vital need to change that the Republicans are trying to push out there, or do they feel like they're along the lines of the Democrats who feel like these are important policies that are used by not just governmental agencies or educational entities, but actually by business entities? What's your sense on where the people of Wisconsin are with this discussion? Because the Republicans continue to keep the accelerator pushed way down in terms of keeping this at the forefront.
And I think the answer to that is that it really depends on the observational level of the people that you're talking to. There are plenty of people that would like to sell you on the notion that, systemic racism doesn't exist anymore, that everybody is judged by the content of their character and not the color of their skin. And yet there are so many metrics that tell us otherwise in the way that our healthcare system outcomes are, maternal mortality, the court system, education. There are disadvantages that can still be addressed in some way that is not a zero-sum game where you are giving a better opportunity for somebody from a marginalized group, does not take away from your own possibilities and opportunities to advance in the world. And yet there are people who want to behave as if, you know, giving somebody else rights or equity or inclusion in something where they've been excluded from is some kind of a threat to them. And it's not. But as long as you have people trying to sell you on that process, there will be people who believe it and who want to say that we don't need these things like DEI or CRT or BLM. And it just means that they are not aware as closely as they should be about the lives and the obstacles to success that some people still face, thanks to politicians like, you know, State Senator Eric Wimberger, who we heard audio of before, talking in committee yesterday about one of these, you know, proposed, constitutional amendments, where he talks about race hustlers. And he says that, you know, there's this con going on selling people on the notion that systemic racism still exists, to which I would respond, yeah, there's definitely race hustlers. I know one when I see one. And I think I'm seeing a couple of them in the way that they're acting in the state and the U.S. Capitol these days.
Isn't that term just disgusting?
It's gross. It's gross. I hadn't heard it before. I put it into my Twitter machine here and saw some of the most vile, disgusting, racist, anti-Semitic tropes that came up. And if Eric Wimberger is smart at all, he will drop that phrase right away before it comes back to bite him hard, and he needs to get off that section of social media or TV or radio, wherever he's getting that information, and talk to the people in his district from marginalized communities and act accordingly, not like he's attached to right-wing media all day.
When it comes to racism and anti-Semitism in this era, and again, we're in the year 2024 right now, you know, I think you and I and millions of other people, we tune in on a Sunday and we watch an NFL game. Last weekend, there was almost 60 million people watching the championship games. And you see in the end zones, you see, stop racism, and you see messages, and you see that throughout, I think, in a lot of different ways around the country and around the world, there's attempts trying to bring people, I think, across the line when it comes to some of these really ill thoughts. But at the same time, it feels as though, again, we are going down a road where we've seen it in history over and over again with increasing examples of both racism, anti-Semitism, and hatred of all ways. What needs to be done? Because I think in some ways, yeah, it's good to have these public displays that say, okay, let's all come together and stop the hatred. But at the same time, these have been going on for a number of years, and it does not seem to be changing the minds of the many people that are pursuing these hateful thoughts and these hateful actions. For leaders, for governmental leaders, for community leaders, do you have any theories on the best way of going about it? Because we do see the examples rising and rising and rising. And of course, I think a lot of it has to do with the leadership that we saw in this country beginning about 8 years ago. But you've been, in the media and in government and in other ways. Any thoughts on what direction we as a people have to go in order to turn this machine around?
I guess the first word that comes to mind is persistence, as well as patience, is just that you can't make, say, the end zone slogans of end racism and we're all in this together. And you can't make that, a temporary campaign that goes away at some point. These are messages of love and inclusiveness that need to be constantly shared. The one thing Eric Wimberger said in his committee soundbite yesterday was something about, racism will always be with us to some degree. And he took that as a reason to say, in so many words, why even, you know, keep fighting it anymore, when he actually should take his own words and say, that's why we need to continually be looking at where's the hatred coming from? How do we offset it? How do we provide opportunities where other people are throwing up roadblocks? How do we come together like the people in Topeka, Kansas, who watched this week as a statue of Jackie Robinson was cut down and destroyed and burned? Like the Grinch coming down to Whoville at Christmas time, the rest of Topeka is coming together and saying, this will not stand. They don't just say, oh, that's a terrible tragedy, what are you going to do? They understood that it is time to stand up as an entire community and say that hate does not have a place there. We need more of that in Wisconsin before the bad things happen. We need that constant communication of, if you can't appreciate what somebody else is going through, listen to their words, listen to their stories, or go actually meet them face to face. Stop assuming that because some angry white guy on the radio or cable TV tells you racism is solved, that racism is solved. That ain't the way it is.
And again, it just feels as though this door was opened by Donald Trump. And people need to realize that this door that has allowed some of the darkest thoughts in people's minds to become in the mainstream was started by Donald Trump. I'm not saying that he invented it, but at the same time, boy, when the president of the United States or a leader of a party, whichever role he's in at any point, basically allows you to let your darkest side show through, there's something wrong there too.
And again, Trump is simply taking advantage of something that's existed for quite a while. And I would ask people to go look at a really good Associated Press story from last weekend about the John Birch Society, which continues to be based in Appleton, Wisconsin, and is where so many of these conspiracies began and continue to this day. It tells you about the roots of these things, how there will always be people that buy into this ugliness, and why it's no less important than ever before that we continue to confront it and rise above it.
Pat Kreitlow, host of Up North News Radio, every weekday morning from 6 until 8 a.m. here on Bow Falls Radio. Pat, thank you very much. Have a great Thursday and have a great weekend.
You bet. Thanks. See ya.
That is Pat Kreitlow again joining us as he does each Thursday here in the first segment of the program. The time is 8:18. Coming up next, we will be talking to Brittany Merlot about the weather here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. And welcome back, Chad Holmes Show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. It is a Thursday morning, lots of sunshine. Boy, looking out the window here in downtown Wausau at the corner of Washington Street and North 3rd Street, it really looks good. Temperature has, again, very mild to start things off. And as we get closer and closer to the weekend, what can we expect weather-wise? Is there any change in the forecast? Well, to find out, we're joined by our meteorologist, Brittany Merlot. Brittany, good morning.
Good morning, Chad. Isn't the sunshine just light up your day?
It really does. I mean, just looking out there, seeing folks getting their day underway as I walked in earlier this morning from the parking garage here to the studio, That's beautiful stuff. I mean, yeah, first day of February, not used to it, but hey, I mean, this is the way it's been. And again, it's the old double-edged sword. I mean, obviously, we see folks who are struggling because of the lack of winter and winter activities. And at the same time, you can really enjoy a morning like this and see the blue skies and see the sunshine, because normally this time of year, we don't see a lot of sunshine. And it's hard to feel up about it, but boy, and it looks like we're going to get some sunshine, aren't we?
Yes, we are. In fact, right now we are lucky. I was just on the phone with Wisconsin Rapids, and they're still in the dense fog right now, and it looks like London. So even just a few miles north here at Wausau, the sun is bright and beautiful. We were 1 degree away yesterday from tying the record high temperature for the last day of January. We hit 47 degrees, and the record was 48 degrees. But today, we might beat it again, because our record set for today, for February 1st, the warmest we ever got was 43 degrees back in 1931.
Amazing stuff. It really is amazing stuff. And we've talked about this. I mean, we keep talking about this. It's just so unusual. In some ways, it is becoming a little bit like the new normal, because we have had rather warm temperatures throughout, you know, either last year and a number of years as well. Are we in the midst of a new normal? Are we going to have to go way up north, into Canada for these winter sports enthusiasts? Or do you think this is an aberration, that we're going to get back closer to normal at some point?
I think we'll always have our ebb and flows of years and the El Nino versus La Nina. But overall, I think climate, yeah, we are on a little warming trend here. Now, the extremes that we're feeling, I think a lot of it has to do, of course, with El Nino and the timing of it all. I mean, I don't know if you remember last year, but early January, we didn't have any snow on the ground either. We had a little warm up in the middle of winter. It's not uncommon. Just how long it's lasting is the uncommon part. The fact that we're going to go into basically a good 10 days of February and still be above average, the length of this is the part that's different out there. So, yes, of course, we've rose into the 40s, into the 50s before, but how long it's lasting is the part that might become more normal, unfortunately. So we are seeing a lot of areas struggling. In fact, a lot of the counties just north and east of us are asking for financial assistance because their snowmobile trails never opened. I mean, right. They have it. Oneida County, this hasn't happened since, I think, like 99 is the latest that they haven't even opened. So, you know, a lot of businesses not excited about this, and a lot of locals, too, depending on the tourism from that as well. So I'm hoping mid-February we can get some snowfall, but unfortunately it's the extended outlook, so I can't promise any significant snowfall just yet, but I'm trying.
Hey, with the temperatures remaining in the 40s, it looks like for the next week or so, we're going to be pretty close to having those golf courses open. All the snow's going to be gone. You can open the golf courses. We go right into spring.
That's true. No, not yet. I want the groundhog tomorrow to see his shadow so we can get 6 more weeks of winter for Wisconsin. I'm sorry. I know a lot of people are shaking their head at me right now.
No, actually, I agree. I mean, I'm not a winter fan, but I do hope that we do get some winter. But has the groundhog ever had an easier task than tomorrow?
So lucky. He gets one day.
But it's going to be easy. All you have to do is say, winter's over. I mean, you talk about the easiest forecast. That groundhog, it's going to be crazy if that groundhog, and again, what is, if he sees his shadow, that means there's 6 more weeks of winter?
Yeah, and we're supposed to have sunshine tomorrow throughout the state. So unless there's a little cloud or some fog passing by.
Well, then you can say, hey, look, that groundhog knows nothing. That groundhog has not gone and studied the weather like you have. So there you go.
Funny, but here's the thing. Do we listen to Jimmy out of Sun Prairie, or do we listen to Phil out of Pennsylvania? Or do we just listen to me?
Well, number one, you. But number two, you have to go closer, because you got to stay within the state. Closer to the source is always better.
I agree, 100%.
All right, let's get to that forecast. And again, it feels like, again, a little like a San Diego weather forecaster. Not a lot of change, is there?
Not a lot of change. We are in a dense fog advisory, even though I see no fog here in Wausau.
No.
If you do head to the south, you might hit some. So keep that in mind. It is in effect until 10 o'clock this morning, but we're going to see sunshine, not really any clouds in the sky, and highs are going to flirt with a record high. We're looking at 42 degrees. If we hit 43, we're going to tie it. If we hit 44 degrees, we are going to beat it. So we are right at record high heat today. And sunshine, and tonight we'll see a few more clouds increasing. Temperatures will fall below freezing to the mid-20s. For tomorrow, we'll stay mostly sunny, bright, and beautiful, highs soaring to the upper 30s. So a little bit cooler tomorrow. But don't worry, as we go into Saturday, low 40s, abundant sunshine. We stay sunny all weekend long, mid-40s for your Sunday as well, and still 40s into next week, but I'm not going to tell you the exact temperatures.
Bring out the sunscreen.
Yeah, don't forget the sunglasses, too. It's something I just realized driving around yesterday. Sun in my eyes. Whoa. Don't forget them.
Brittany, thanks again for the information. Have a great Thursday, and we'll catch you again tomorrow.
Sounds good. Have a good day.
That's our meteorologist, Brittany Merlot, joins us at 8:20 each weekday morning here on the program. Right now, again, plenty of sunshine as we look outside. 31 degrees is the temperature. Northwest winds at 6 miles per hour. So a wind chill factor of 25. The dew point is 29. Relative humidity of 92%. The barometer at 29.88 inches. And the visibility is 5 miles. Again, we're fortunate. Sounds like in other areas of central Wisconsin, seeing some rather dense fog. Time for an information update. We'll find out about news, weather, sports, all coming up as we continue here on this Thursday morning. Chad Holmes Show. Bull Falls Radio 98.9 and 1230.
You got a great imagination.
School sports news after this.
Do you ever wish you could be in two places at once? With homework, carpool, practice, and everything else, sometimes you just can't make it to every game. But the NFHS Network's streaming platform makes that a little easier. For just $11.99 a month, you can watch unlimited high school sports live and on demand, at home or on the go. You can watch online or on one of our mobile or connected TV apps. Visit NFHSnetwork.com and subscribe today to never miss another game.
On Wednesday, the WIAA Board of Control gave final approval to a five-division girls volleyball plan that will increase the number of divisions and expand the combined boys and girls volleyball state tournaments from 3 days to a four-day affair. With the change, Division 1, which will remain eight teams for girls compared to four for the other divisions, will hold quarterfinals on the Wednesday afternoon and evening of the state tournament. The boys volleyball state championship game will now take place Friday evening, with all five girls title matches held on Saturday. The Wisconsin Basketball Coaches Association announced the six finalists for the Ms. Basketball Award on Wednesday, which goes to the top senior girls basketball player in the state. The finalists are Tegan Mullaney of McFarland, Kale Peterson of Waupun, Taylor Stremlow of Verona, Ali Isabel of Nina, and teammates Trista Feda and Gracie Gresh of Notre Dame. On Thursday, the boys' finalists for Mr. Basketball were announced by the WBCA. The group includes Dupree Fletcher Jr. of Carmen Northwest, Tim Franks of Homestead, Nick Janowski of Pewaukee, Jaquan Johnson of Pius, Con Knipple of Wisconsin Lutheran, and Amari McCautry from St. Thomas More. Speaking of St. Thomas More, the D3 top-ranked Cavaliers downed third-ranked Dominican 112-96 on Tuesday. McCautry had 35-10. This has been a Wisports.net Minute. Check us out online at Wisports.net.
And welcome back to Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio 98.9 and 1230. online at BowFallsRadio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. The time is 8:37 against sunshine, 31 degrees in downtown Wausau. Have not had a proper chance to say hello to our producer, Ian Welsh. Ian, good morning.
Good morning, Chad.
Feels like I've been riding the wave here so far this morning. I've been just running around trying to get everything set up and ready to go, having a few, again, technical issues in terms of trying to get us connected with a couple of those guests early on, but doggone it. As long as we got them on the air, it's bottom line, it's all good.
That's always the issue with technologies. It's always, the hardest part is always figuring it out before you actually get the hang of it.
No kidding, huh? But again, I know that you're continuing. Last night, you got a night off from your rehearsals because you were helping me here for the big high school sports show. So when I said early this morning that's what we were, it's just because I was here last night along with Ian doing our big high school sports show. And in fact, coming up in the next hour, we will hear our student athlete interview with Marathon senior Grant Warren, just having a fantastic season, having a fantastic career, and a very thoughtful young man who will be going to a Michigan Tech great school to continue his academic and athletic careers. We'll hear our conversation with him coming up in hour number two of the program at about 9:20. But you are back at it tonight. Have you been looking at your script? Have you been making sure that you're ready to go without that book ready to roll in these rehearsals?
Yes, I've been making sure. I have been keeping on top of my lines and working on my tap dancing number, focusing on the music, making sure just every little small thing are coming together, because now, officially, we are 2 weeks away from our first show. So
you open 2 weeks from tonight, Thursday night.
Yep. So it's a little bit of pressure, but it's a really great cast, really talented, a great crew. I mean, we're all very friendly and very professional. Sometimes we get a little noisy from time to time, but that's just who we are. We're theater people. We're usually pretty hyper. So
Right. No, that's all good. And I tell you, I mean, and it's good still to have that little bit of nervousness. I mean, I tell you, even doing this, being on the air, doing a sports broadcast, if you don't have that little bit of added energy when you're ready to go, when it gets to be 8:06 in the morning or 7:00 at night, whenever that broadcast begins,
exactly,
you gotta be. If you lose that excitement, then there's something wrong. And how many shows have you been in? I mean, how many? Do you have a rough idea? Man, you're just like me now.
Yeah, I have something in my throat. But
you breathe wrong, all of a sudden it's a very thin line.
But no, but I kept a resume of every show I've ever done, and I've been doing a theater since I was about 12 years old. And if you include the Drowsy Chaperone, I currently have done about, I think, 68 shows.
68?
Yeah. That's the reaction I usually get when I tell people, because
that is amazing.
Middle school.
That should be our number for the day, I think, right there. 68. Oh, holy cow, that is an amazing number of shows.
I've done a wide variety of shows, played a wide assortment of different characters, and every show is just, it's always something a little different. And I try new things, I meet new people, I learn a lot more about different aspects of the theater with every show, but I always do it just for the fun of it. And I enjoy every minute of it.
Fantastic.
That's the reaction I usually get when I tell people. They're quite surprised.
Fantastic. Terrific job. And continue having fun. And the countdown truly is starting to begin, 14 days away. And coming up the Monday of the show, we'll be talking to your director and really digging into what's going on with this show. Drowsy Chaperone opening in 2 weeks at the UWSP at Wausau Venega Theater. So, again, we'll continue to be updated on that. So, very good.
Thank you.
Hey, Green Bay Packers have their next defensive coordinator, Jeff Hafley. And I have to admit, I really have no idea whether this guy is a good hire or not. He leaves Boston College. He was the head coach at Boston College for the last 4 years.
Okay.
Going 22-26. He had previously been a co-defensive coordinator at Ohio State. He has coached secondary in the NFL in the past, but has not been in the NFL for a number of years. But he will be the new defensive coordinator in Green Bay, replacing Joe Barry, who was let go after the end of the season. So, again, I got to say, and we're going to talk about this tomorrow when we have Mike Clemens, our Bow Falls Radio sports reporter, in, and also talk Wisconsin sports with Paul Mickling. And I was talking to Paul, and his theory was you have to bring in somebody that has done it in the NFL, that has a record of success as a defensive coordinator, and this is not. This is another young hire, a guy that is part of the same generation as Packer head coach Matt LaFleur. But in the end, he decides to go with Jeff Hafley. So, again, I don't know.
There's no nepotism in there, right?
Like, is the best part of this.
He's not related to anybody on the Packers team?
As far as I know, there is no nepotism involved. So that is a plus.
That's good, because it needs to be about experience.
You are exactly right. No nepotism.
No favoritism here.
And the thing is, if he is able to use the talent on the defensive side, it will be a great hire. And if not, people are going to start hashtag instead of hashtag fire Joe Barry. It'll be hashtag fire Jeff Hafley. So
let's give him a chance first.
You're exactly right. So
let's give him a chance before we decide to jump on the social media bandwagon.
So very true. Also, last night, it was an interesting night in Portland as Bucks superstar Damian Lillard returned to Portland, site of so many of his great games and great seasons. And in the end, it was not a great return because Lillard and the Bucks fell to the lowly Portland Trailblazers by a score of 119-116. Anthony Simons hit a go-ahead floater with under 20 seconds left in regulation to give Portland the lead they would not relinquish. He led Portland with 24 points. Giannis led the Bucks with 27. Lillard had 25 points, 7 assists, 6 rebounds. He had spent the first 11 years of his career in Portland. The Bucks are now 0-2 under new head coach Doc Rivers. They will continue their Western road trip coming up Saturday night. Another tough game in Dallas, taking on the Mavericks and former Bucks head coach Jason Kidd. Bucks are now 32-16. Coming up tonight, we don't have one but two high school sports broadcasts here on Bow Falls Radio. Tom Weaver will be in Marathon as the Marathon High School boys basketball team will take on Pacelli, 7 o'clock for the pregame. Live right here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. I will be over at Newman Catholic tonight. The Newman girls basketball team will host Rib Lake. That game will be on the Sports 2 stream of bowfallsradio.com and the Civic Media app, starting at 6:15 for the pregame. They're tipping off early at 6:30, and that game will also air on tape delay following our Marathon High School coverage tonight here on Bow Falls Radio. Also, real quickly, it is almost playoff time, and the first playoff seedings were announced. The Wausau West Warriors in Division I hockey, they're in sectional number one. And the seedings were announced for that bracket last night. Chippewa Falls is number one seed in the bracket. You got Stevens Point number two, Hudson number three, Eau Claire Memorial number four, Superior number five, Wausau West number six, Wisconsin Rapids number seven, Eau Claire North number eight, DC Everest number nine, Marshfield number 10, East Merrill United number 11, Ashland number 12, and Barron number 13. So that what that means, Wausau West will host East Merrill United in a regional semifinal in the first round of the playoffs coming up in 12 days on Tuesday, February the 13th. With a victory in that game, the Warriors would advance to a regional final at number 3-seeded Hudson on Thursday, February the 15th. So I'm hoping that I will be in Hudson on Thursday, February the 15th, while you are opening up your show, The Drowsy Chaperone, at the Venega Theater on the 15th. But,
yes,
my plan is to come and see that show. I know I have a game on Thursday. I'll have a game on Friday. So either...
We have two shows on
Saturday. So Saturday, I'm going to try to get there. Have to depend on what my schedule is, of course. I have to look at it. I don't know if I have a game or not. I think I might. Do you have any shows on Sunday or is it just Saturday?
No, it's just Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
I'm going to have to hope to have to squeeze that little bit of time in there somewhere. Cause
Saturday is a 2 o'clock and a 7:30.
Okay, so hopefully if I have a game in the afternoon, be able to get to the night show. If there's a night game, I have to look at my schedule. Sometimes I'm afraid to look ahead. There's
only
so many things on there.
It's only a few weeks away, but it's going to be here.
But by the third and fourth shows, you guys will be rolling full steam ahead, right?
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
So I'll be there when you got that machine running down the highway just perfectly. So,
yep.
So again, busy time. You got the Drowsy Chaperone. You got high school playoffs coming up and all sorts of good stuff. And, of course, we will be bringing you coverage of Wausau West, Newman Catholic, and Marathon High School Sports basketball and hockey in the postseason playoffs. It'll be a very exciting time. The time is 8:48. I'm Chad Holmes. Sunny skies. Again, beautiful start here on this Thursday. Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Chad Holmes Show on Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, bullfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. Sunny skies, 31 degrees in Wausau. Again, 1 degree away from a record yesterday in terms of the temperature. Got up to 47 degrees. That was warmer than we expected as we continue to set records in terms of warm temperatures for this winter. Groundhog Day is tomorrow. We'll find out what the groundhog has to say, but I think generally warm weather, in fact, for the next week. Except for tomorrow, where the temperatures will be back in the 30s. It's going to be 40s, low to mid-40s every day for the next week as we look ahead on the forecast.
It's not really a February weather. It's more of April weather now.
As I said, we could be getting those golf courses open pretty soon.
Well, my dad will be happy about that.
Yeah, you're exactly right. Hey, do you know how old the oldest person in the United States is?
Oh, well, I have heard stories of people getting over 100, but if I had to guess a number, I'd say the oldest would probably be maybe 106.
Actually, the oldest person in the United States coming up on Monday will be turning 116 years old.
Holy smokes. It's
an early happy birthday to Edith Ceccarelli, who turns 116 on Monday, February the 5th. Edith, who lives in California, is the oldest person living in the United States. and is also the second oldest living person in the world, after Maria Brañas Moreira from Spain. She was born in 1908. Do you have any idea who the President of the United States was in 1908?
Oh, boy. I don't know my history that well, but I don't know off the top of my head. I'm sorry.
Teddy Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt was the President of the United States when the oldest person currently in the United States, Edith Zeccarelli,
was born. Well, she has lived through a lot of history, though.
Well, the thing about it is, as well, there's a sad aspect to it. The nice thing about it is she was very active very, very, very late into her life. She danced regularly well into old age, lived independently until she was 107, which is really amazing, and moved into a retirement home at that point, but now does suffer from dementia and was able to walk with a walker until her 114th birthday. So, again, you know, and that's the thing. It's wonderful to live very long, but you wouldn't want to live, at least my personal feeling is, where you're not able to, you know, the dementia is such a sad disease. It is.
It really is.
I mean, I think as long as the mind is sharp, even if you're forced to live in a wheelchair, if you're able to lose some of your mobility, if your mind is sharp, you can still, I think, have very much a full life. But when your mind is not there, then in addition, not be able to have any mobility.
That's like the old saying goes, a mind is a terrible thing to lose.
Yes, it is. And so again, we're seeing people live longer and longer lives. Mentioned Teddy Roosevelt, but our first president was George Washington.
Oh, yeah.
And there's something, this is a weird story involving George Washington's time. A lemon.
He emphasizes a wooden tea.
Well, yeah. But a lemon, and I don't know how you can know this is for sure, but a lemon that dates back to when George Washington was just a child recently sold for $1,780 at an auction in the UK. The auctioneers had no trouble confirming its age as it was inscribed with a historical message that read, given by Mr. P. Lou Franchini, November 4, 1739, to Miss E. Baxter. Dubbed as a dried citrus in the auction house listing, it is unclear whether Miss Baxter kept the fruit as a treasured keepsake or she simply had a dislike for lemons. The fruit was discovered in the bottom drawer of a 19th century chest brought to auctioneers by a family during a house clearance. The family claimed that the chest once belonged to a deceased uncle. The auction house made the decision to sell both the lemon and the chest. The chest managed to fetch only around $40.
Jeez.
So, again, it's interesting stuff. I mean, and...
yeah, that's pretty funny. I mean, was it the lemon was actually had that written on it?
Somebody they wrote down, and I don't know whether in the 18th century that means that... the lemon meant something like this. Was that a sign of love? Here, my girlfriend. I love you. Here's a lemon. I don't get it. But
it must have had a hidden meaning or something. But yeah, it was definitely. That's not something you hear of every day.
Exactly
nowadays.
And also, finally, another interesting story I came across this morning. I'm a huge fan of science, but often I'll get home from a game and I'll get home and, you know, make myself something to eat. It'll be after 9:30. Mm-hmm. And at 9:30 every night on Fox WSAW or whatever ZAW, they have Seinfeld reruns at 9:30, 10. Mm-hmm. And usually I'll watch them. But Larry David, the comedic genius behind Seinfeld, he co-created it with Jerry Seinfeld, has, again, denied rumors of a reunion. He expressed his frustration over the persistent speculation. He said, I'm tired of people thinking I'm lying. We're done. It's over. Yeah, it's over. So get ready next week for the announcement of the big reunion show. No. It sounds like it's done. But Seinfeld still lives on over and over and over again in reruns.
I mean, why mess up a good thing, all right?
And they already had a reunion, actually, on Curb Your Enthusiasm. They had a Curb reunion where they're...
Oh, yeah.
It was very, very funny. But the time is 8:58. We're going to find out what's happening around the world, around Wisconsin with Terry Bell, around Central Wisconsin with Brittany Merlot, and what's going on in sports with Mike Clements. We give you all the information you need, top and bottom of the hour, and then another hour with me, Chad Holmes, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230.